Morning, everyone. Can I have all of you? Hello? Hello? Yeah. Welcome back, everyone. And for those who are coming back from overseas, we welcome you again. For those who are in quarantine, we also welcome you back. Thank you very much. Yeah, God is good. All right, I'd like to give you a rundown of the announcement today. First announcement, Working Bee next week, next Saturday, between 9 and 1:30 p.m. So if you can make it for any time between these, that'll be good. Yeah, so we need everyone here if possible. And also we have Holy Communion service next week at the main hall. So for those who are in the BYG, you are required to join the Holy Communion with the rest of the congregation member. And once the communion has finished, you will come back here for your Bible study. Okay, so only the first 20 minutes, I think. Yeah. So if you can sit, I don't know how you're going to sit, at the back row or the front row. Yeah. Just talk to your group leader, please. So the next English service will be held on the 8th of March, and the speaker will be Billy, and the chairman will be Jari, and worship team is with Sylvia, and is team 3A. So please take note. And also, this the first radio meeting, this first radio meeting will be on the March 7th, 6:30 p.m. in church. And I'd like to call John because he'd like to share with you about the kitchen renovation extension. Thank you.
Morning, everyone. Just a quick reminder announcement that the kitchen renovation committee has put together drawings that will be sent for presbytery endorsement shortly after that the congregation has had the opportunity to review. So we tendered to three construction companies and the boards decided to engage Dukon Construction. The cost for constructing will be $160,000 and our building funds currently sit at $80,000. Please continue to support and financially and in prayer. We humbly ask that you set some time to have a look through the drawings which we'll put behind and forward any objections or queries to myself or other members of the committee, Gio Tondas, Sylvia, or Supi. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, John. Shall we now open with a word of prayer? Let's pray. Dear Lord, Father in heaven, you are the almighty and righteous God. We are so privileged that we can gather here to worship you this morning. Thank you, Lord, for sharing us your mercy and faithfulness in every day of our lives. Please examine our hearts and cleanse us of all our wrongdoing so that our view of you will be right before you. We thank you for Daniel Sihombing for his ministry of your word to us this morning. Please bless him and his family as he made time to share your holy word with us. Dear Lord, please use him mightily and guide him in the path that you have planned for him. Lord, we invite your Holy Spirit to move freely among us. Come to us in each of our hearts to equip us, to teach us, to comfort us, and to help us live victorious life every day. We commit our worship team and all the supporting ministry into your almighty hand this morning, that through their serving, they can experience your love and learn to know you more. We pray that our worship of you will be right and acceptable according to your standard. We commit all this in Jesus' almighty name. Amen. Now I'd like to call Jesse to leave out in the time of worship.
Thank you, Louis, and welcome once again, everyone. It's good to see you all. Before we start our worship, I'll read the book of Psalm, number 150, verse 1 to 2. Praise the Lord, praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his act of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. So I invite all of you to stand and let us sing the new doxology.
Receive more creatures in below. Receive more of you.
Spirit, God is faithful, and God has been amazing to us since beginning. Not only He created us according to His image, but His unconditional love to us is the greatest gift to humankind. He sent Jesus to save us, to redeem our sin. So let us reflect what He has done by singing the wonderful cross.
Endure forever. And this year I'd like to remind myself, and I hope to remind you, that we are created being. God is the creator. So if you can imagine that or put that in your mind, then you will appreciate God more, because we are here not because of our own doing, because He put us here. He loved us, and He had to put Christ on the cross. So we are the recipient of that gift. So I hope that we're all grateful for what He's done for us on the cross. Let us pray. Our gracious and merciful Father, you are a listening God and God who answers prayer. This morning, we'd like to pray for Helen, who is serving in Japan, Nagoya, as missionary. We pray that you will provide all her needs and she will be able to overcome all her difficulties with your help. We pray that she will faithfully depend on you when sharing Jesus with students in university campus. We pray for her protection and good health. We pray that she will not be discouraged when result is not visible. Instead, learn to live in faith like Abraham. We also pray for all our congregation members that we will learn to walk in faith and continue to serve you with the gift that you have entrusted to us to manage. Thank you, Lord, once again for your mercy and grace upon us every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us prepare our heart one more time. Let the Holy Spirit help us to understand his word. I invite you all to sing, "Open Our Eyes, Lord." The reading is taken from the book of Psalm, number 2. I'll invite Nicholas to read the Bible verse for us.
Today's scripture reading is taken from Psalms chapter 2. Why do the nations conspire and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth take their stand, and the rulers gather together against the Lord and against his anointed one. Let us break their chains, they said, and throw off their fetters. The one enthroned in heaven laughs, the Lord scoffs at them. Then he rebukes them in his anger and terrifies them in his wrath, saying, I have installed my king on Zion, my holy hill. He said to me, you are my son. Today I have become your father. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your inheritance, the ends of the earth your possession. You rule them with an iron scepter. You will dash them to pieces like pottery. Therefore, you kings, be wise. Be warned, you rulers of earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you will be destroyed in your way. For his wrath can flare up in a moment. Blessed are all who take refuge in him. This is the word of God.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you in humility, asking your guidance. Help us to understand your word, O Lord. Let your spirit bring us light. Open our heart and mind to be ready for your teachings, and may we be able to understand your will in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay. Today I will talk about happiness. This is not an easy topic for me. You know why? Because I think almost everyone here is living a good life, aren't we? Yeah? You know, Melbourne is often awarded the title the most livable city in the world. Last year, Australia is number 10 in the world happiness ranking. And it used to be higher. We are all happy people. Look at you. Look at the person sitting right beside you on the right and the left. Look. See? Everybody is smiling. Yeah? Everybody is smiling. Everybody looks happy. That's why happiness, I think, is a difficult topic to preach. We probably think we know about it. We may think we already have it. But even though that's the case with all of us today, it's always good to listen to what the Bible says about it, right? Okay, so now we go to Psalm 2. Do you remember when we read the Bible earlier? Where does the word happiness lie? Okay, there was no word happiness in the translation that was used. But it is actually at the end of the chapter. Can you find it? What does it say? How blessed are all who take refuge in him. Yeah? In many other translations, the word that's used there is happy are all who take refuge in him. So some of the English translations might use the word blessed instead of happy. It is like Jesus' Sermon of the Mount, if you remember, in Matthew 5, where you can read it, happy are those who are poor in spirit, or in other versions you can find blessed are those who are poor in spirit. So the word happy or blessed here is coming from the Hebrew word ashrei. What? Ashrei. Yeah? So happy or blessed is coming from the Hebrew word ashrei. What is ashrei? It is a word that is only used 26 times in the whole psalm. And 20 times elsewhere in the Old Testament. So what do you get from these statistics? What do you get? This is more often used in the book of Psalms than elsewhere in the Old Testament. Yeah? The whole Old Testament is only 20 times, but in the book of Psalms, it's 26 times. So yeah, that's why it's the book of songs. We know that the book of Psalms is the book of songs, yeah? Happy are those who take refuge in God. Happy are those who have their forgiveness of sins and all those things. So it is interesting that it mostly appears in the book of Psalms throughout the whole Old Testament. It seems that the theme, happy, is characteristic of the book of Psalms, right? Now, it is also interesting to see that the word ashrei in Psalm 2 is paired with the same word in the earlier psalm. Let us check our Bible. So this is Psalm 2. So what is the earlier chapter in the book of Psalm? Chapter 1. Okay, let us see our Bible. Where is the word happy in that psalm? The first one, yeah? Okay, Psalm 1:1. Yeah. Happy are those who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked. And then we find in the closing section of chapter 2, happy are those who take refuge in God. So, the first psalm and the second one together form the introduction to the whole book that consisted of 150 psalms. They indicate that the main theme in the whole book of Psalm is Ashrei. Happy are those. Okay? Now, what is Ashrei? And what does the Bible mean with happy here? From my study, I learned that Ashrei is primarily identified as a relational experience defined in terms of desired associations or experiences. Most often translated happy, it has to do with being in right relationship with God. Ashrei is not to be confused with be happy attitudes. It is more a consideration of what makes authentic life and existence possible. Here we see the unique perspective from the Bible about happiness. It is not about the fulfillment of what we want. It is not about pleasing everyone. It is about relationship with God. Okay? Again. It is not about the fulfillment of we want. It is not about pleasing everyone. It is about relationship with God. Let us speak this together. First one. Happiness is not the fulfillment of what we want, is not about pleasing everyone, is about relationship with God. Now, these other two, in point one and two, are the concept of happiness that are normally held by other people in general. Isn't it true? Yeah. Happiness as the fulfillment of what we want. What's the problem with that? The problem is that we actually rarely really know what we really want. Is that true? When I was a kid, younger than you, all of you here, I was an ardent fan of football game. I always read football magazine. I play football almost every day. I watch football matches in TV. I even wake up at midnight just to watch football games and feel very sleepy the next day in class at school. And you know what? Most of the football matches are played where? In Europe. This is soccer in Australia, yeah. Are mostly played in Europe. So I wished since I was a kid that one day I would be able to watch football matches live in Europe. Yeah. That was my dream since I was a kid. Oh, I really wanted to see those players in real life. Are they real? Yeah? Or maybe is it only in TV? Billy is smiling. Perhaps he had the same dream. And this wish was fulfilled about 8 years ago. I got this opportunity since I was studying in Europe. And I was so happy at that time. I was thinking, okay, now I want to see football matches in European stadiums. So I watched two football matches in stadium, live. for first one, when I went there, I felt like, whoa, they are all real. Oh my goodness. Yeah, so I thought, well, it's not only in TV, it's not a movie. Yeah? It's not a movie, it's real. And then the second one, I watched also in football stadium. But surprisingly, the second didn't feel as good as the first. And then there was never the third. So I only watch football games twice in European stadium. Although it was my dream since I was a kid. So you see, I believe many of us have similar experiences. The moment we get what we want, what we wish, then the fun is gone. If not gone completely, then perhaps just some part of it. So that's why, interestingly, there is a secular thinker, but I think he says an interesting statement. This is a Slovenian philosopher, yeah, Slavoj Žižek. It's very difficult. Yeah. So he says that the problem is that we don't know what we really want. What makes us happy is not to get what we want, but to dream about it. Yeah. Yeah, in my case, that was what happened. Yeah. I was so excited when I dreamt about watching football matches in stadium, but the moment I get it, yeah, I'm not as happy as before. So this is what's wrong with the first one. Happiness is not the fulfillment of what we want. It's very tricky. Happiness is... So we think we really want something, and we are really sure that if we get it, we will be so happy, the happiest person on earth, and then exactly when we really get it, the fun is not there anymore. It's gone. So the idea that happiness is about getting our wishes fulfilled is a bit problematic. And then the second one. Happiness is not about pleasing everyone. This is also a concept that is quite popular in our world, isn't it? When we make everyone happy, then we are happy. Happiness here is assumed to be achieved when there is no conflict, when everything seems peaceful and calm. I can imagine that this is tempting for teenagers especially, who in their stage of development normally tend to seek the approval of their friends. I hope I don't sound like I'm judging here. Yeah? It's I said normally. So if you are not like that, you are exceptional. Yeah? You are special. So I think almost everybody here, like the adults, yeah? Were you like that? Yeah? Oh, everybody say yes. Yeah. So we are not judging the teenagers here. So it's just normal in the stage of development. And that's also something that I experienced too when I was a teenager. I tried to make myself accepted by my friends in school. I was worried about my appearance, the way I dress, the way I walk, the way I talk, that they might be different to what's considered normal. Happiness for me was pleasing everyone. What's wrong with this concept? What's wrong with this concept? The problem is that in reality, and I think as we grow older, we realize it more and more, in reality, we cannot please everyone. Yeah? We cannot please everyone. And in fact, the text that we reflect upon today tells us to pick a side, and indicates that when somebody follows God faithfully, there might be a consequent conflict. Let us see again our Bible. When we look at Psalm 1, the word happy there, what does it say? Can somebody read it for me? Yeah. Blessed is the man, or happy is the man, who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers. So do not here suggest conflict. Yeah? Suggest a decision not to follow the path that other people take. To say no to other people's counsel. To reject an opportunity to join a company. And then the second one, when we look at Psalm 2, let's look at Psalm 2, verses 1 and 2. Can somebody read it from the slide? Somebody? No? Nobody wants to read? Okay, I'll read it. Why do nations assemble and people plot vain things? Kings of the earth take their stand and regions intrigue together against the Lord and against his anointed. I highlight the word against here. Yeah. And here the conflict is even more explicit. Here it is depicted so dramatically that nations assemble. People plot vain things. Kings of the earth take their stand against the Lord and his anointed. Can you imagine the United States, European Union, the Great Britain, Russia, China, North Korea, plot against us here? Against us here? A small Burwood Community Presbyterian Church against all the great nations of the world because we are God's anointed ones? How scary can that be? This is even worse than the threat of coronavirus, yeah, that has made a lot of people worry about, or the bushfires last month. Yeah. This is even scarier. So this is what happens when we follow the way of the Lord. It's possible. It's not always the case, but it's possible. So happiness is not pleasing everyone. The Bible says, happy are those who take refuge in him, even though all the nations, all the great nations are against them. And then the psalm here ends up with the word happy. Happy are all who take refuge in him. Happy are those who remain faithful despite the odds. Happy are those who dare to say no and follow their convictions in the way. This is the happiness that is promised in the book of Psalms. It is not the fulfillment of what we want. It is not about pleasing everyone. It is about our relationship with God. It is for those who take refuge in God. This is what makes our lives authentic. And this is Ashrei. This is the happiness that is promised in the Bible. Let us pray that the Lord will help us to live a happy life in his way. Amen. Let us pray. Oh Heavenly Father, there are so many things that the world around us offer. Things that often promise fulfillment and happiness. Give us wisdom, O Lord, to discern what is good and what is not. Grant us the courage to say no to what may displease you. Thank you for letting us having a moment of reflection. Help us to do your word in our lives. Let your word be the light on our path and the lamp to our feet. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Daniel, once again, to share the words of God to us. To respond from the word of God, let us give thanks to him according what our heart decided. Not only monetary we offer, but our lives to be used for his kingdom. Let us sing together, "Take My Life and Let It Be." Like the song we just sang, help us to give the best of what we have. Our gift and life are from you. Help us to use it according to your will. And thank you once again, Lord, for your blessing upon us. We give back small portion for what you have given to us. Please accept this offering for the expansion of your kingdom. And through this, may your name will be glorified. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Before we go, the closing song that we are about to sing, I feel like this is like an encouragement for us, especially from what Daniel has shared to us from Psalm. Yes, it's about our relationship that give us hope and faith in God. Even though we face the hardship, maybe, you know, when you grow up in the school, or now you are in the uni or even in the workplace, people against you, they reject you, but you know that only through Christ that you are able to longing or to hanging there and keep striving in your faith. So let us together, let us sing together, "Yet Not I, But Christ in Me."
To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus.
And do the work of the Lord. Let us seek happiness in the refuge of the Lord only, and let us receive the blessings of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace. Amen.
Please be seated and have a moment of silence.